From the time Brother Michael told me the team, the spirit of care, I'm trying to look through my mind and scan through my mind on what I can bring that would be of some benefit, what I can bring that will somehow be in line with the team to bring edification and build up the brethren as they keep walking this Christian race. And then my mind went back to 2 Samuel chapter number 11. Y'all remember the story very carefully, that when you read this story, David is in a place where he's not supposed to be. Saw Bathsheba, called Bathsheba. Y'all already know what happened. I don't have to get into details of the story. But then Uriah came home, Uriah being one of the right-hand man of David, being one of the individuals that was concerned about David. He's caring, he's one who fight and lose his life for David. Came home, David tried to send him home. He said, no, I'm going to chill with you, David. I'm going to be here with you all night. And so David decided that he was going to orchestrate a plan. And what was captivating to me in this verse is, as David wrote this letter, the Bible says that David said, put Uriah in the forefront in the hottest of the battle. But that's not the nice part to me. That's not even the interesting part to me. The interesting part is this. The text goes on to say that he said to them that when they are the hottest part of the battle, that you need to withdraw from him. Don't miss this. They said when he's in the hottest part of the battle, you need to withdraw from him. And I find that to be really interesting, because this helps me to understand that Uriah did not die because he was afraid of battle. No. Uriah did not die because he was afraid of battle. He was a man of war. He was accustomed fighting. He knew what fight looks like. He knew what battle was like. He did not die because he was afraid of battle. He did not even die because he was in the hottest part of the battle. No. He did not die because he was accustomed to fighting in the hottest part of the battle. Uriah then died not because he was in the hottest part of the battle, not because he was afraid of the battle, not because he was untrained, unskilled, or unprepared, but Uriah died because his brethren withdrew from him. Uriah died because the folks who he trusted left him exposed. Uriah died because the individuals who he depended on abandoned him. Uriah died because the people who he placed his confidence in did not show enough care to stand with him. Brethren, I don't know about you, but I believe that's an interesting and important word for every believer. Because sometimes in our Christian race, what happened is that they are individuals who are dependent on us. They are individuals who would place their confidence in us. And sometimes the reason why they run into trouble is not really because they are afraid of running the Christian race. It's just because they don't have the support that they thought they would have. They don't have that brother to stand by their side. They don't have individuals who would continue fighting with them no matter how difficult life becomes. And I believe many of the churches need to understand this principle very carefully, because too many times, for too long, we have left folks exposed rather than showing the spirit of care because of our own desires. We have decided that we are going to follow our own patterns. We are going to live our own way. And we have left our brethren exposed. Brethren, it is sad when people of God who claim to know God, love God, and trust God would see their brother in some difficulty and hardships and withdraw from them in that moment. I don't know who I'm talking to, but I'm sure that we all have this one person who we thought would have been there for us, and when you run into the jam, they're nowhere to be found. Yeah, we can all tell the story of individuals who you thought would show up, but instead of them showing up, you were there fighting alone. And now you are disappointed, you are hurt, and you are losing the battle, not because you are afraid of the battle, but you are losing the battle because your brethren left you exposed. But then can I tell you this, if we are to be true children of God, and if we are to demonstrate the spirit of care in time of difficulties, hardship, and indiscretions, we ought not to withdraw from our brethren, but we ought to be able to cover and help our brethren. Brethren, the church should be a place where individuals come for refuge. The church should be a place where folks feel welcome, where folks are able to understand that we know what it is like to live a difficult life. We know what it is like to fight the pull of this world. We know what it is like to go through different struggles in this life. But sometimes that's not the way we operate. Can I tell you how we operate in the church sometimes? We operate in the church as if we are the most holy. We have never sinned in our life. We are Jesus' little cousin. We are the fourth person in the Godhead. You know, we just operate as, you know what? Nothing is wrong with us. We have it all together. Yeah, that's the way we operate in the church. And so folks coming into the church sometimes are not able to relate to us because we make them feel as if we have no struggles in our life. We allow them to believe that everything is all worked out in our lives, that we met Jesus and everything is fixed. All right, Jesus, you've done a good job and now we are perfect in the sight of Christ. That's the way we have allowed individuals to believe. But I've dropped by this morning to tell you that the reality is every one of us have some type of struggle. Y'all not talking back with me this morning. Y'all don't like this. But every one of us have some type of issue that we're dealing with in our life. And in times of difficulty, we ought not to leave our brother and our sister exposed, but we ought to have enough love. We ought to demonstrate the spirit of care so that we can cover them and help them wherever we can. Any comments or question?
Not yet.
All right, let's look at another text. Genesis chapter number nine. The chapter is number 9. Can someone start reading from around verse number 20 for us? Genesis chapter 9 and verse number 20. Genesis chapter 9 and verse number 20. Watch this with me.
And Noah began to be a husbandman.
Uh-huh.
And he planted a vineyard. And he drank of the wine and was drunken.
Uh-huh.
And he was uncovered within his tent. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father and told his two brethren without. And Shem and Japheth took a garment and laid it upon both their shoulders and went backward and covered the nakedness of their father. And their faces were backward and they saw not their father's nakedness.
All right, you can stop right there. Now, the thing I love about the Bible, brethren, is that the Bible is never shy in showing the flaws of faithful men. That God would oftentimes reveal the follies and the issues of these men, even though they had a relationship with God, even though they trusted God, that God would often show up their issues. And so we jump into this text, and in Genesis chapter number 9, the Bible says that Noah became a husbandman, a farmer. Noah started to deal with the soil and plant up his stuff. And as Noah started to plant, the Bible says Noah started to have a drink or two. Yeah. Noah started to have a drink or two. While he's having that drink of two, he lost track of time. He lost track of a whole bunch of stuff because now he became drunk. Well, watch this, brethren. Noah became drunk. Although Noah was the same one that God found favor in, although Noah was the same one that was saving the ark, although Noah is one who we remember today, one who we adore today, one who we respect in scripture today, the Bible says Noah was drunk. Brethren, that just tells me that it doesn't matter how much times you read your Bible. It doesn't matter how much times you pray to God. It doesn't matter how much times you attend services. That we all find ourselves every now and again in some type of indiscretion. Yeah. We all find ourselves in some type of indiscretion every now and again. And that's Noah. Noah found himself in a situation where he started to drink. And while he started to drink, he got drunk. But as you keep reading the text starts becoming interesting because the Bible says that Ham came on the scene and recognized that Noah was naked. And when Ham recognized that Noah was naked, what did Ham do? Watch the Bible. Watch the text with me. He went where? He went outside. And we need to stop right there because that's some good news right there for us. The Bible says that he went outside. How many times, brethren, do you find that there are individuals with issues in the church? And instead of we being discreet and helping that individual with that problem, we leave and take the problem in the church and we go. How many times we find that there are brethren who are willing to spread the issues of folks in the church to their friends and families who are on the outside. That's what happens in the church. Y'all can sit there like if you don't know what I'm talking about, but that's what happens. Something happened in the church, and before you know it and you walk down the road, you are able to hear what happens on the street. Yeah. And the Bible says Ham saw this. Now, in the Old Testament, to see someone's nakedness, Noah was in a shameful and embarrassing state. And so Ham, what he did was not something good. The Bible then says that he went outside and he told his two brothers. But I really want you to see the difference between Ham and the difference between his brothers. That Ham saw the indiscretion of Noah. And when Ham saw the indiscretion of Noah, he went outside and told his brother. When his brothers heard of the issue, the Bible says that they took a garment and they walked backwards to cover their father. We brethren, we need some folks in the church who are willing to walk backwards to cover the indiscretion of individuals. We need some folks who would demonstrate mercy and have that spirit of care enough so that they can cover the issues of brethren, cover the flaws and cover the follies of individuals, not spreading and gossiping about the problem. We need folks in the church who would develop the spirit of the brothers of Ham and do exactly what they did. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're saying, well, how can we cover someone's fault? You know, we are not commanded to do that. You know, the Bible tells us, you know, that we ought to talk to them about it. We ought to let them know about it. No, this is the thing you need to understand. When we talk about covering someone's issue of faults or indiscretion, we are not talking about condoning it. We are not talking about concealing it. But when the Bible uses the term cover, it is used in reference to forgiveness. No amens, that's all right. It is used in reference to forgiveness. And so what happened is the covering is the picture, but the principle is forgiveness. And so when the Bible talks about covering, he's talking about forgiving. And one of the problems in the church is that folks don't want to forgive folks for stuff they did. You cannot develop the spirit of care and not be willing to forgive. That's an oxymoron, brethren. That just does not go together. Oil and water can't mix. Well, that just can't mix either. You cannot say that you are a true child of God and still not be willing to forgive others. And I just love this text in Genesis, because the Bible said that they walk backwards. They did not even look. They just walked backwards. They wanted to cover the indiscretion of their father. Brethren, do we have folks in the church today who are willing to do the same?
Yes.
Are we willing to cover and forgive the issues of individual? Most of us are like the prodigal son, older brother. We know the story of the prodigal son, but his older brother have some qualities that we find abiding in the church. The prodigal son went on his way, had his merry time, came back home, and instead of his brother being glad, his brother is mad. His brother is upset. And the thing that always amazes me in the text, the brother starts saying, well, why are we having a feast for him? Why are we doing this for him? Why are we celebrating him? He went outside and prostituted. He went outside and wasted his money and do what he had to do. And the text never said that's what his brother did. Y'all missed it. The text never said it, brother went out there and prostituted. All the Bible says is that he wasted his money in good living. But he added what he wanted to add into the text, which led me to believe that probably that's what he would have done. And so sometimes the reason we are mad at folks is because in our minds we're thinking they went out there and enjoyed themselves, and I had to be in here fighting up with being a Christian. Y'all not saying?
Yeah.
And we're upset with them because we wanted to have a good time, but we didn't. Brethren, that's our attitude. That's our attitude at times. And so we're upset when they come back, when the reality we should be so glad that they have made it back, because God did not have to grant them mercy to come back into his kingdom, but God saw it fit and God allowed them to come back to his kingdom. And we are so blessed when they come back, because heaven is rejoicing and we should be rejoicing too. I see someone have the mic, so that means someone wants to say something.
A question. Mm-hmm. I know you don't know, but I have a sister with issues, and I want to ask, based on the example that you just gave, how does one forgive when you're angry about the situation?
How do you
get past your anger to now feel that caring and forgive?
Well, this would be my answer. To be able to get past the anger, you must look at the cross. And when I say look at the cross, you have to look at Christ and his sufferings. And the question we must ask ourselves, how did Christ and God get past the fact that we were sinners, undeserving of forgiveness, but still granted us forgiveness? If you don't look and see the cross, then it will always be difficult for you to develop that same that Christ had. Now you see, the reason many times we find many things difficult is because we try to do it within ourselves. But the only way to really do this is doing it within the help of Christ. Now, have you ever noticed that when the scripture talks about the love of God and so forth, in 1 John chapter number 3, I believe he said, what manner of love is this? In other words, he's saying this is strange to us. The reason it is difficult for us to forgive is because that's not what we do. If you hit me, you better bet I'm going to hit you back. That's how we know it. We don't know this thing about loving your enemies. That's not where we go. You know, I remember when I was younger, you know, and I'm growing up, the way I knew it was that if you hit me in school, we're going to have a fight. That's just how I don't know anything about going to tell the teacher. It's only probably until I got big I started realizing, you know, but I know if you hit me, I'm going that. And when we are believers, when we came out of the world, we came out with that same mentality. And so we came out from the fact that if you love me, that's how I'm going to love you back. But if you don't love me, I'm not going to love you. That's our attitude. But when we come into Christ, Christ teaches us to break that pattern. Break that way of thinking. And so now Christ saying, start saying some crazy stuff as love your enemies. Pray for those that willfully you. You know, that's one of the things that willfully use you. And I have to sit down, kneel down, whatever it is, and pray for them. He starts saying some stuff that's uncomfortable us. I always call these commands, these are the hard commands of God. You know, there are some commands we're good with. Yeah, God, we are fine with that. But there are some things that's difficult, and forgiveness is one of the things that's challenging for us. When you have been hurt to the core, when someone have hurt you deeply, it is not easy to always forgive that person and see them eye to eye. But brethren, as we grow in Christ, and as we look at the fact that Christ forgave us, I think that should be a motivation and encouragement to help us along the path to forgiving. So I don't know if that answers your question.
I am thinking to another way that we could look at that is to put yourself in the position. If you were the one had done the hurtful thing or the wrong thing, I think you would want to have the personal persons forgive you, so you can look at it from that angle also.
Yeah, I don't know if you're reading my notes, boy. You're probably going to have a little problem. That's what I said. Anyone else, as we jump to 1 Peter chapter 4, 1 Peter chapter 4, because I want you to remember the text in Genesis chapter number 9, but I want you to see something in 1 Peter chapter 4 and around verse number 8. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse number 8. And I'm not doing much of the reading this morning, so someone else, if you can read for us, that will be nice. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse number 8.
And above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves.
Uh-huh.
For charity shall cover the multitude of sins.
All right, that's all we need. That's all we need. The Bible says, and above all, have fervent love for one another. Why, Peter? Because love covers a multitude of sins. Now, you have to understand that Peter is writing to brethren who are going through extreme suffering and persecution. And so as Peter writes, he's writing to them to help them to understand that they need to have proper behavior in the midst of difficult time. And one of the ways Peter does that is Peter says, if you want to be able to face what is on the outside, you need to build up yourself on the inside. And so he tells them that if you are to get through the difficulties, you need to learn to have love one to another. But not just love, he says fervent love. The word fervent there comes from a Greek word which means to stretch beyond your limit. It means to go way beyond, as you would see an athlete in his full stride. That's the idea of the word fervent. So the Bible is saying you need to stretch and have as much love for one another. Why? Because love covers a multitude of sin. Brethren, well, if you look at this verse in particular and you read the story in Genesis chapter 9, you can almost see the connection right there. Because the love and the concern of the brothers or the sons of Noah is what allowed them to walk backward to cover Noah. And that's what Peter is saying. Love covers a multitude of sin. I'm just so glad that Peter said a multitude of sin, because sometimes it is easy for us to believe that we only have a few sins in our lives. But Peter wants us to know, hey, this thing is not about a few, it's about multitudes of sin. That's how much we fall, that's how much we have follies and issues in our life. But he said, the love that you're going to show is what is going to be able to cover a multitude of sin. And as I told you before, it does not mean concealing sin, it does not mean condoning sin, but it means forgiving sin. That's what love means. When he said love covers a multitude of sin, he's really saying love forgives a multitude of sin. The problem is we have messed up the definition of love so much that we find it difficult to demonstrate Christ-like love. One of the things I've noticed in scripture also is that there are certain words that God does not leave it up to us to define. And one of those words is love. So when God says love, he also tells us what the definition of love is. And you all know 1 Corinthians chapter 13 very well. That's the definition of what love is. Love do not hold on to any wrong. Love is not puffed up. We know that's the definition of love. However, today we have changed that definition of love to mean a whole bunch of stuff. And we have moved away from God's definition. And so we find it difficult to practice what God wants us to practice. We find it difficult to demonstrate the kind of love that God wants us to demonstrate. I remember in the book of Ephesians chapter number 5, the Bible says, you know, husbands, love your wife as Christ. Yeah. Y'all don't even know how difficult that is. He said, as. No, I'm trying to help you understand this. Because, all right, I'm sorry. But this is it. He said, love. We could have settled right there. But he said, as Christ. And if you know anything about the love of Christ, you know that's no easy task to meet. Because when you see the love of Christ, it's the love of Christ that caused him to have a lowly birth. How can the highest one have a lowly birth? How come can the richest one become the poorest? Why? Because of his love. The love of Christ is what kept him on the earth. The love of Christ is what kept him pinned on the cross. And so when the Bible says love as Christ loved, he's saying love to the same extent of Christ. And that's a great challenge, brethren. Sometimes we love, but not to the extent as Christ. And that's where the challenge is for us as brethren. We have to love to the extent that Christ loved. Peter says love covers a multitude of sin. When Peter says have love for one another, Peter is giving us what we would call something that is reciprocal. So to love one another means that you need to show me love and I need to show you love. Now the reason that's important is because this, brethren, watch this. There will be times when you would be the one showing love. But there will also be times when you would be the one needing the love. And that's why Peter says love covers a multitude of sin. Because there will be time when you would be the one covering. But there will also be times when you would need covering. And that's why it's important for us to have love in our life and pattern our lives after Christ, demonstrating that kind of love so that the church can function and be what God wants it. What God wants it to be. Brethren, this is one of the scriptures that blows my mind every single time. The Bible says, by this they would know that you are my disciples. By what, Jesus? If you have love. It amazes me because Jesus never talks about doctrine. Jesus never said, you know, if you go out there and you teach with energy and enthusiasm, that's not what he says. He said the way folks are going to know that you are my disciple is if you have love for one another. Which means that it's our love that will attract and capture the attention of the world. And I just believe that we have not been doing a good job in showing love. And that's why many times most folks are not attracted to the church as they ought to. That's what happened. I told you before that the church has become a place where everyone is just looking for the faults of others to condemn them. But that's not how it should be. It should be a place of love. We should have an atmosphere here of love that when folks come in from the outside, they are able to see something that is different. Yes. A love that is abnormal. A love that allows us to realize that you might have an indiscretion, but we don't spread it and gossip about it, but we help you to get better. Even that's what the text says. The Bible says those who are spiritual restore such a one. Help that individual to be what God wants them to be. Don't go spreading the issue all around. And I just believe if the church, that's my belief, brethren, if the church can become as loving as God wants it to be, then the church would win more individuals in the world. Yeah. I'm just a firm believer of that. That we would win more folks into Christ if we are able to show love rather than condemnation. Yeah. Now, as one brother said, you'd win more folks with honey than salt. That's you'd win more folks. And if we are able to show that Christ-like love, I'm just a firm believer that we will draw individuals into Christ.